Hello friends, so I hope you are preparing well and watching our videos. And in the last lecture we had discussed about the permanent settlement and judicial and other reforms of Cornwallis. Today we will first start with the questions which has been asked on the permanent settlement, which has been asked in the UPSC examination, and then we will move to the next topic, that is Lord Wellesley, who introduced subsidiary land system, and subsidiary land system is very important for examination point of view. So we will see that also in detail. So here in the UPSC mains examination, the question was asked that the permanent settlement in Bengal was a bold, brave and wise measure. Comment. Now see, why the permanent settlement was bold, brave and wise measure? As we had already discussed in the lecture, that the company was eager to devise a method through which it could secure the land revenue regularly. However, the method which was adopted by Warren Hastings, that is quinquennial settlement or one-yearly settlement, could not succeed in fulfilling the objective of company. So what Cornwallis did, that he made the settlement itself as permanent, and bold means because at that point of time the company did not have machinery, did not have sufficient officials to collect the revenue, so they made Indians only responsible for the collecting the revenue. And also bold because by one stroke of pen, by one regulation, he created a class of zamindars and deprived the peasantry from their own traditional rights of land. So if you have gone through the lecture carefully, I hope that you can easily answer such kind of question. Then the next question was asked, the permanent settlement thou initiated with best of best intentions was a sadly blunder. Comment. Now see, as we had seen the merits and demerits of permanent settlement, then at that point of time we had seen that intention was good. That means the Cornwallis hoped that since they did not have sufficient officials or machinery to collect land revenue, so they needed an intermediary. But they thought that the settlement would be permanent so that the zamindars would take interest in the development of agriculture. They will bring, encourage peasants to grow, bring under cultivation more and more lands. Also, the zamindar was expected to introduce modern technique to improve the productivity, etc. But what it ended, that zamindars were only interested in profit and rent seeking. They exploited peasantry, they lived in cities and spent luxurious life. So therefore, what it resulted in? Ruining of the agriculture, the destitution of and poverty of peasantry. In fact, it created serfdom at bottom and zamindar at top. So two socially hostile classes, and obviously in the long run company itself was in loss because the settlement was permanent and the revenue could not be raised. So even if there is more productivity or better monsoon, etc., then also the company was getting the only the fixed share what was promised in 1793. And because of this AV system, what happened that in the latter phase, we will discuss that peasant movements and some of the modern day problems also, like Naxalbari, etc. So obviously the intention was not bad, but it resulted in a blunder. Then the third question was, absentee landlordism was a consequential feature of permanent settlement. Comment. Now as we have seen that because of permanent settlement, absentee landlordism grew because the landlords were not living in the villages, or they were not interested in the agriculture itself, but they merely were interested in profiteering. So if you have gone through the lecture, the characteristic of absentee landlordism, etc., then you can easily answer such kind of question. Then the next question was, the permanent settlement disappointed many expectations and introduced their results that were not anticipated. Explain. Now see, this question and the question best of best intentions were sadly blundered. Both are of similar kind. So the answer of both will be more or less similar. So if you have gone through the lecture, you can also answer this question, that what were the drawbacks of permanent settlement. So with this, I hope that questions based on permanent settlement can be easily answered, or the rule of Lord Cornwallis can be easily answered. Now we will move towards another very important topic, that is subsidiary alliance system introduced by the then Governor General of India, Governor General of Bengal, Lord Wellesley. So now we will see Lord Wellesley. He was Governor General for 1798 to 1805. Now, during this phase, as we have seen that the company has already become a political power and the company was eager to protect its territory after the Battle of Buxar. So, company made offensive-defensive alliance during Clive. As we have seen that the company made the concept of buffer state. Then during Warren Hastings, company made the concept of ring fence. So these all were intended to protect the territory of company, and basically these were defensive in nature, to defend themselves. However, the Wellesley at this point of time was very eager to make company as a paramount power, meaning thereby he did not want paramount power, meaning thereby he did not want that Indian ruler should have any kind of capacity to challenge the authority of the company. Because at this point of time, if you see, then there was Marathas had recovered from the Battle of Panipat, became a stronger under Peshwas. They had also modernized their army based on European lines and employed French soldiers to train their army. Apart from that, Mughal Emperor was also protected by Marathas. Then in the far south, Tipu Sultan was posing a great danger because he was ruling over Mysore and he also employed French soldiers to train the army. He started modernization, etc. We will see Anglo-Mysore War, the characterization of the period of Tipu Sultan. So all these alarmed Wellesley that at some point of time, if we don't disarm these Indian powers, then their own territory may become vulnerable on the count of Indian princes. So he made an offensive system. He no longer believed in the defensive system, but the offensive system, which was called subsidiary alliance system. Subsidiary alliance system. Now, one thing we should also know, that what was the objective of Wellesley? Obviously, the main objective of Wellesley were threefold. That means the one, to protect company's territory, East India Company's territory. Then also to disarm Indian rulers. And the third one was to counter French menace in India, because at this point of time in Europe also, France was growing stronger. Because after French Revolution, at that point of time, the Napoleon had, and when we will see the world history, we will see the French Revolution and the rule of Napoleon from 1799 to 1815. Napoleon had become the first consul in 1799, and he was posing threat to Asia also, because he had already attacked Italy, conquered it, then Rhine State Confederacy, that means present day Germany, then he was moving towards Egypt. So with this, after conquering Egypt, he could get a direct land route from West Asia to towards India, and he had made the alliance with the Tsar of Russia. So all these developments was happening in Europe, and the French were also eager to support Indian rulers, and that's why, as we have seen, that the Marathas, then Tipu Sultan, etc., were making treaty with the France to modernize their army. So this alarmed Wellesley. So Wellesley said, thought that no, we have to get permanently disarmament of Indian rulers so that they could not unite or they could not pose any danger to our territory. So with this, he introduced the system known as subsidiary alliance system. Whether the French danger was real or it was merely a pretext is a matter of debate, because different historians are having different viewpoints. Some historians say that French danger was real because of all these developments, but some historians say that no, French danger was not real because the plan of Napoleon to attack India through all the West Asia route and covering such a vast area, etc., was obviously not workable. So sooner or later Napoleon had to abandon that. However, all that historical debates are going on, but still there was a perception in the mind of Wellesley that there might have been some French danger. So now he introduced the system called subsidiary alliance system. See, Wellesley did not invent the subsidiary alliance system, because the use of subsidiary alliance was perhaps first time initiated by Dupleix in the Carnatic War itself. So obviously Wellesley did not invent it. So, but he made the use of subsidiary alliance system on a war footing and make it as a more as a weapon or as an instrument to disarm Indian princes. So what were the provisions of subsidiary alliance? Under the subsidiary alliance system, those Indian rulers who signed treaty with East India Company for the subsidiary alliance had to surrender their foreign relations. So they could not make treaty peace with any power, whether Indian or European, but could only communicate to foreign powers through East India Company itself. So the East India Company was the main arbiter for the foreign relations. So suppose Nizam signed it, then we will see Nizam signed, Peshwa signed, etc., then they had to communicate to any other foreign power with through East India Company only. Now the second thing was, the Indian rulers have to maintain an army commanded by East India Company's officers. So So basically the East India Company's troop was stationed in the territory of Indian ruler. Then for the maintenance of this army, larger states like Awadh, Hyderabad, etc. has to cede territory to East India Company in full sovereignty. That means on these territories, the rule of East India Company was granted and they could make arrangements for land revenue, etc. for the maintenance, but the smaller states were asked to pay in cash for the maintenance. So see, first they deprived their foreign power and sovereignty, then they deprived them having the army also, and then said that you have to pay for the army. So they have to cede territory or to pay in cash, depending upon the nature of the state, whether smaller or larger. And the fourth provision was, a British resident, that means East India Company official, a British resident were put in the headquarter. Meaning thereby that in every province like Hyderabad, Karnataka or Mysore, a British resident was put to see the day-to-day affairs, that whether some kind of conspiracy is going on or not. So a British resident was put. Then the Indian rulers had to dismiss all Europeans into their services. Meaning thereby they could not appoint French, etc. And then the last provision was that the East India Company will not interfere into internal matters of the territory. So they said that you can rule independently, but you have to follow these provisions. So these were basically the provisions of subsidiary alliance system. Now we will see the pros and cons of subsidiary alliance system. So we will see the pros and cons of subsidiary alliance system. Now see, Wellesley was basically an imperialist and egoist also. So he did not care for any other opinion but an opinion of himself. He himself called as Bengal Tiger. So these are some kind of questions which is asked in the prelims examination, that which governor general is called Bengal Tiger. So he himself called Bengal Tiger. So by the subsidiary alliance system, Nizam of Hyderabad accepted it. Why these powers accepted? Because they did not have any other option, because the army was very stronger, and therefore they could not sustain a war. So the Hyderabad accepted in 1798. Then Mysore accepted in 1799, because Wellesley said Tipu Sultan to accept subsidiary alliance system, but Tipu Sultan refused. Then the fourth Anglo-Mysore war occurred, and in which Tipu Sultan got defeated and he got martyred, and then the old dynasty, that is Wadia dynasty, was put to the throne, and he was forced to sign the subsidiary alliance system. Then Awadh accepted it in 1800. Then Peshwa, through Treaty of Basin, these are important from the prelims point of view, Treaty of Basin accepted in 1802 the subsidiary alliance system. Then Wellesely of Berar, who were feudatory of Peshwa, also accepted in 1803. Then Holkar accepted it in 1804. Then Rajput rulers, Rajput rulers of Jodhpur, Jaipur, Bharatpur, Bharatpur, Bundi, etc. They also adopted subsidiary life system. So see, the whole of India was made dependent on the company for the foreign relations, then for army, and a British resident was put at all these places. So company got the strategic command of India and virtually became the Lord Paramount of India. Then what was the pros and cons of subsidiary alliance system? So basically the impact of subsidiary alliance system. So the impact on subsidiary alliance system. So obviously impact will have on two sides, one on the East India Company and other on the Indian princes, Indian rulers. So we will see impact on the both. So for the East India Company, obviously the impact was very meaningful because they disarmed Indian powers, made them subordinate companies. Army got strengthened. Then the British resident was present in the capital, so it also reduced the chance of any conspiracy, and he also interfered in the day-to-day matter, and also only favored those officials interfered into day-to-day matters, only favored his favorites for the throne. So as you will see that this also created difficulties. For example, Treaty of Bhadohal was signed in 1839 with Sikh, but again the British resident, because of British resident there became an uprising, and the British army invaded and Punjab was annexed in 1849. So we will see the annexation of Sindh and Punjab. Apart from that, the company also got territory, successfully encountered any challenge was reduced. Then the French menace was also countered, and because of British resident, virtually the East India Company was present in every province. Apart from that, they countered French menace, then they became the paramount power in India. And one more thing which is very important, that is the company became the arbiter in case of any dispute. So all these were the benefit for the company. Company also got revenues because of the territory or in cash for the army. So company also got revenue. So because of all these features, it is also said that the subsidiary alliance system was the Trojan horse tactic of Lord Wellesley. So it was of immense importance for the East India Company. Now what was the impact on Indian princes? So what was the impact on Indian rulers? So the impact of Indian rulers, what was the impact on Indian rulers? Obviously, they lost their independence. Lost their independence, became dependent on the company, dependent on East India Company. Then they surrendered all their foreign powers, that means their foreign relations, that means they could not rule sovereignty, could not retain the sovereignty. Any chance of remedy was, over, because the East India Company was now the paramount power. Then the demand was so high that it was nearly 1/3 of annual revenue to pay for the maintenance of East India Company. So because of this, the Indian rulers day by day became financially bankrupt. Financially bankrupt. Because they very often fell into arrear. The administration of provinces got worsened. And because there was financial bankruptcy and also the presence of British resident made it very difficult to function independently, because he used to interfere into Delhi affairs. He also promoted the only the loyalist element to the throne. So always weak successors were supported. Apart from that, on the side of people also, so the Indian rulers were only now ruling in name but not in fact, because the British resident and East India Company become, because see, if you don't have the control of army, if you don't have the control of treasury, that means revenue, then you are merely a puppet in the hands of East India Company. Then to overcome this financial bankruptcy, they also taxed their people very high, taxed higher, and because of this ultimately the people suffered. So all these were the impact on Indian rulers. Now we will conclude Lord Wellesley, because subsidiary alliance system is the main area from where the question is asked. Apart from that, he also for some kind he opened a training college for East India Company officials to get trained for their administration in India at Fort William. So sometimes it is also asked in 1800. However, the court of directors opposed it, and in 1803 it was shifted to Britain. The college was shifted to Britain because they said that we will train our officials in Britain only and not in India. So this was also because of subsidiary alliance system, the company, East India Company, got direct land route to connect different provinces, to connect different provinces. For example, before this, only the sea route was used to connect from Bengal to Madras and then to Bombay also. But now, since all the Indian states had accepted subsidiary alliance system, so there was direct land route, so better connectivity for the company in case of need, emergency. Then in 1803, He also captured Delhi and Agra and made Mughal Emperor as pensioner and dependent on the company itself. So all these were also the development during Lord Wellesley. Then to counter French menace also, by the Treaty of Amiens signed in 1802 by Napoleon and England, the Pondicherry was returned to the French. Then he also made treaty with Portuguese in Goa not to employ French, etc. So all these were minor points. These are the major points. Apart from that, now we will conclude the rule of Lord Wellesley. So basically, obviously, the statement of Karl Marx is also very significant here, that if you divide the resources of a province between two governments, then you are sure to cripple the administration of both, which we had already seen in the dual rules. Then also a historian, Sir Thomas Monroe, had said about the consequences of subsidiary alliance system, that by accepting subsidiary alliance system, a ruler purchased peace but surrendered independence. Now see, obviously this statement is very much valid, because subsidiary alliance system was not to get attacked by East India Company, but they lost independence because they surrendered all their power of military revenue and then also the foreign relation. So subsidiary alliance system was obviously humiliating for Indian princes. Then Sidney Owen, another historian, had said that Wellesley, by subsidiary alliance system, Wellesley made the British Empire in India to the British Empire of India. Obviously, because before this, the company was also a ruling power in Bengal, but it was one among the many princes, but now many princely estates, but now, so it was British Empire in India, but now they became the British Empire of India. That means the whole of India lay at their feet, because all the estates have been disarmed, all the kind of rebellion or chances of revolt was taken away. So these two are very significant statements. Apart from that, Percival Spear had also said that under Clive and Warren Hastings, Clive and